I'm Donna Maxey, and I'm the founding director of Race Talks, and we're really happy that you're here. And this is Race Talks 2, and if you're not here for the community police forum, then you're in the wrong place. If you are, then you're here. Okay, and we were supposed to get started sooner, and I apologize that we didn't. Our speakers are off doing some kind of meeting. Everybody and their mama is retiring from the police force. They had one last night, one tomorrow. So one of our speakers is just leaving the retirement party. So we had quite the lineup for you. But hopefully these assistant chiefs and the chief will be here. So our speakers are Chief Mike Marshman, Operations Chief, Assistant Chief Chris Uehara.
Uehara.
I want to do Star Trek. Uehara. Investigations with this Mathew Wagenknecht. Did I say that right?
Yes.
And Services is Assistant Chief Mike Leloff. And our person who will not be coming is from the Police Association, Portland Police Association. To give you an update on the union, that is Daryl Turner. And Assistant Chief Uehara has saved the top management. He's going to come and join us here at this table.
Thank you.
You're the first management person to come?
Yeah, we just got one.
I heard.
6:30?
No.
They had it for 6:30 on the news.
Are you kidding me?
Yes. So he's early.
Pardon me? Yeah, it's 6 o'clock.
It's okay.
Six o'clock.
Sit down. Sit down. I'll beat you up later. And then giving an update on the COAB, the Community Oversight Advisory Board, for the Department of Justice will be Reverend T. Allen Bethel. He's here, and he's out right now. So wanted to share with you that at next month, Tuesday, November 22nd, we're going to have another community police forum at Franklin. It's for Franklin High School at the Marshall High School cafeteria site. And that's out on 3905 Southeast 91st Avenue in Portland. And then after that, next year, we'll be moving out to the outlying districts, Reynolds, Centennial, all the school districts that are serviced by the Portland Police, so that the community has a chance to come and meet the police chiefs and talk to the officers, and so the officers can hear what the community thinks. I think it's a really important thing to do. And then at Miniman's Kennedy School, we're going to have a documentary on March, it says March 8th, but that's not right. It is November. I believe it's November 8th.
Is that election day?
Yes, it's election day. So, but you will have already mailed in your ballot, so it won't matter, right?
Yes.
You won't be like some people I know who drive up at the last minute, you know, at 7:52 and drop their ballot in, but I don't do that anymore. Okay, so we're doing a documentary film of Dr. Otis Moss III, and he will be speaking. He's the Collins Series speaker for the Ecumenical Ministries of Oregon. He will be speaking on Redeeming the Soul of America, Race, Justice, and Reconciliation. And he's coming on November 3rd to Concordia University, so if you're interested in being a part of that, you should get in touch with the Ecumenical Ministries. And actually, if you do the sign-in sheet, there's a sign-in sheet on your table, and then put your name and email address and your information on here, and I will send you a copy of that bulletin so you can know what he's doing. So that should be very interesting, and we have a panel of local religious leaders. The Ecumenical Ministries has very interesting speakers that come every year. One year, you might have heard, they had Bishop Desmond Tutu, who was their speaker. So Reverend Moss is very interesting. After President Obama, I don't know if the word is endorsed or supported gay rights, he was really lambasted by the community. The African-American community, particularly, and the Latino community, tend to be very anti homophobic. So he was, and some ministers supported the homophobia. And Reverend Moss spoke out in a very public way and said, you know, and quoted the Bible and used scriptures to support that. So he uses his pulpit as a place to produce and bring about social justice change. So hope to see you there. Okay, so our police are here. We're going to be working on this. But I'm thinking we maybe should reverse this, since you're here and all the panel is not. And are they coming soon, you think? Okay, so Reverend Bethel is coming right now. Maybe by the time the three of you finish speaking, the other three will be. The other two, anyway. So hopefully that will happen. And then we will break into small groups. If you look at in your baskets, there's information for you. There's a Race Talks brochure. There's paper, there's pens. You know how people always say, I would give you my number, except I don't, you're right there. I would give you my number, except I don't have a card. So that's what these little colored cards are in here for. Now you don't have an excuse. You have a card. You have a business card. So what we'd like for you to do is to share with each other. Also, we'd like to ask that you that there be at least one person of color at each table. This is Race Talks. And one of the things I like to point out is that you cannot talk about race unless you have a person of color in the conversation. Just like you can't really have a real conversation. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, it's kind of like men sponsoring a birthing conference. They are involved, and they really are, you know, part of it, and they can be supportive, but they really don't know the experience. And guys, I know you probably say, yeah, I was there, I saw this. Oh, you have no idea what this is really like. So, and that's the same thing with the racial experience in, so it's the same thing with the racial experience here in this country. So officers, if you're not one of the assistant chiefs, I'd like you to pick a table and split up. And don't sit close to each other. Like those two are sitting close to each other. Don't sit close to each other. Because you're going to be tempted to talk to each other. See those three? I noticed you three are back there close. Split up. So we want you to split up and be all over the auditorium so you can talk to different people and get a different perspective. So our panelists are here. Thank you very much.
Great. I apologize. I've had on my calendar 6:30. I know you're a school teacher and you start on time.
No, we did not start on time this time. So, and Dale Turner's not here either. He's claiming traffic is horrible. So, would love for you to take out a Race Talks brochure, and we're going to go over the ground rules right quick. Ground rules are on the very back. And Race Talks is a very interesting place to come and talk. We've had all kinds of people come and be a part of Race Talks. We talk about all kinds of things. We talk about race, the intersection of race and sexuality, the intersection of race and religion, the intersection of race education. Whatever has to do with race, we're talking about it. I don't know if you know, but by the year 2040, there will be more people of color than there are white people in the United States, and it's real important that we get to talk to each other and get to know each other. People are scared that we're going to have a race war only if we all participate. And the truth of the matter is that we all want the same things. You know, I think Abraham Maslow said it best, that there's a hierarchy of needs. And it starts with safety and goes all the way up to actualization. I think it goes beyond actualization. There's one after that, self-actualization. So the goal is for us to get to know each other. And so we have some rules. The ground rules are listen to each other with curiosity. And really listen. I mean, how many times, and I'm guilty of this like everybody else, somebody's saying something and you're formulating your response as opposed to listening to what they really have to say. So listen with curiosity. Respect differences. This is the one that I think that makes Race Talk so important. Agree to disagree. That's where most of the arguments come in, is that somebody's trying to convince somebody else of their point of view. You don't have to convince me of your point of view. Just tell me your point of view, and then when I understand what it is, I'll go and cogitate and kind of chew it up a little bit, and then come back and go, might be a point to that. But if you try to force it on me at the time, I'm just going to push back just as hard as you're trying to force it. Speak from the self and from the heart. I'm notorious for saying I know somebody who. And I do know somebody who, but that's not my story. I can only tell my story. I can't tell somebody else's story. So that's important that we do that. Respect confidentiality. The people who are at your table are going to share things, and this is the amazing thing about race talks, is people will share stuff that they have never told anybody else, not even family members, at these tables. I hear sometimes what some of the conversations are at race talks, and I'm like, really? It's kind of like one of those airplane or at the bar kind of conversations where people, you know what, you guys, you can laugh. This is okay. This is okay. I really like for people to laugh a little bit because it kills the tension. If you are so serious, life is serious enough. We got to learn how to laugh about it. Because if you're just serious about this the whole time, it's going to eat you up. So respect confidentiality. You can tell somebody's story, but you can't tell who said it. You can't say Joe Jones, who lives on 39th Street, and he drives a such and such kind of car, said, but you can say this guy said, and that's cool. Contribute honestly and positively. Assume positive intent. One of the things I like to tell people at race talks is you will stick your foot in your mouth. We all do. And my job as a facilitator is to help you take your foot out of your mouth and keep somebody else from putting their foot somewhere else on. Because you're going to, you know, that's the human nature, is that we are going to, that was a joke. Good. Great. Come on. People are a tough crew. Tough crew. So assume that people are trying to be positive. They might ask what's to you a stupid question or make a stupid comment. And how many times have each of us done that? But we did not realize that we were doing that. So be forgiving and assume that the person is trying to be positive. I can give you a perfect example is that I shared with somebody I was talking to, and she happened to be a white woman, and she said something about you gals, something, something, and I went, I just listened to what she had to say, and then afterwards I said, you know, I just wanted to share something with you that's not something that you say to African-American women. That's an insult. Now, when someone says something to you, just accept the correction graciously and don't say anything else. This person didn't do that. She told me, well, I took a course for 4 hours from Chris Jones from the nonprofit organization, and he never said that was a problem. And I thought, oh my gosh, 4 hours worth of training, and you know it all. We're just going to keep working on you. I said, well, just something to think about. Maybe you should call him and ask him. So, and I asked him, told him about it, and he said, she never asked me. So, I don't know. I didn't know what her name was. But, you know, be open to new ideas. Listen to what other people have to say. It doesn't mean that, you know, there's something for all of us to learn. And one of my white friends, my last one was relax and enjoy. And my white friend told me, guy I consult with said, white people are not comfortable talking about race. So he made me put in here, you may experience discomfort. So, and that's okay. That's okay. I've been talking about race for 6 to 7 years, probably in the womb. But, so it's okay to be uncomfortable talking about it. It's not the what, it's the how. So feel comfortable, ask questions, whatever. So those are our ground rules, and that being said, I'd like to introduce our first speaker. It is Chief Mike Marshman, and we're running a little late, so I'd like to make sure that you guys have at least an hour at the table, and the last 15 minutes, we like to do networking, you know, those little pieces of paper so that you can know who you are. So, and there's also an evaluation there, and on the so please fill that out before you go on. On the back of the evaluation are the questions that you will be discussing in your group. So, and in the basket is paper to take notes, if you'd like to. So, And so I'm going to give, you guys 7 minutes each. You're the chief? Come on.
Well, I don't know if you had like a specific content.
I want you to, this is about race, this is about what is your idea for, you know, for the community, what are your thoughts about race, how are you going to deal with it, what do you want to do? You can talk about the fact that a lot of your people are leaving, retiring.
Yep.
And what are you going to do about that, and that you're recruiting? Talk about that.
7 minutes. Okay. Hey, all right. Apologize for being late. I know Donna Max is a teacher, so we started on time. My calendar said 6:30, so sorry if we started at 6. So Mike Marshman, a new chief in the city of Portland. Race relations. Where to start? So I was born in Newark, New Jersey. And my first, I had a class, but I'm not going to where you said I had a class before, but I had a class once. And the conversation was, what is your experience with somebody of color? And this will sound kind of negative, and I'm going to set the tone with negative, but raised Catholic, and I was in a Roman Catholic church in Newark, a bunch of rocks come through the windows in the 60s, and the chance of die, Catholics die, and the National Guard got us out. That was my first experience. I actually didn't really set. Moved there, moved to Chicago. And there, where I grew up, it wasn't like black and white. It was Hispanics live in this neighborhood, Italians live in this neighborhood, Germans live in this neighborhood. So it was more, I guess, ethnic based. And that's just kind of how I grew up. Go to school, end up coming to Portland, and this is probably the hardest place for me to live, frankly, because it's kind of white, really, really white. And a lot of religions too. I mean, it's not just about race. I mean, it's about everything, I assume, in this meeting. When I grew up, pretty much in Chicago, kind of a lot of folks are Catholic, big archdiocese, except for a little group of Jewish people up in Skokie. That's just kind of how I grew up. Neither good nor bad, just kind of how it is. Come here, and I really am very, very personally confused about religion, because a lot of religions here that I've never heard of until I moved here. And just kind of wondering, what is the conversation about race? Just didn't really understand it. Started getting into police work, obviously, here, digging into the history of Portland. Now, I don't know other cities how police race relations work, if it's the country as a whole, which I think is obviously part of the conversation, the national narrative, versus the specificity of what happens in the city. So in this city, teacher officers about redlining, Vanport, taking out the homes to put in I-5. So when the officers I hire now, how many in here remember Rodney King? Quite a few. The reason why I asked that, and there is a little bit of a segue here, I'm hiring officers now who weren't born when Rodney King happened. Thank you. Okay. Yeah. Because to me, Rodney King's not history. I worked during Rodney King. But some of the folks I'm hiring today, Rodney King's history to them, because they weren't born yet, right? So it's not, so it's like at what point, how far back do you go? The reason why I say that is when we go into certain neighborhoods where I worked, I could come in jeans and a t-shirt. I looked at one way. I try to teach our new officers, when you come in with this stuff on, besides being a male, besides being white, you carry stuff with you, right? I try to put myself in other people's shoes. I will never say I understand what it's like to be in your shoes, because I can't. But I try to put myself in your shoes to where, if I try to picture myself how it would be if I, as a white guy, walked in to your comfort zone, to your culture, to your business, to your home, wherever it might be, with all this on, you know, I'm bringing some baggage with me that even as a chief of police, I don't fully understand what I'm bringing with me. But I need to know, and everybody that works in the City of Portland Police Bureau needs to know, there's some negativity that comes with that. What do you do with that then? I think it's okay, as Donna said, to make mistakes and just simply say, you know, I know there's a history here with race relations in Portland, with race relations in the country. There's some negativity to the profession I work in. It might not be be me personally. I don't want my folks to take it personal, but I'm bringing baggage with me and have a conversation. And I've always had good success with that as a conversation foundation to start from, and just kind of work from there. Easier said in this environment versus in a home where you get to a call, it might be contentious. I mean, it depends on where you're at. I'll watch my time. That's kind of the history. I know. Two more things. Hiring. I think I went to three or four retirements today. But I also hired 14 officers today. I think we have put that on our website of our new officers, the promotion ceremony. If you have time, you have nothing else better to do, if you want to watch a promotion ceremony, skip the mayor, skip me. I put me in there too. Look, if you only have time, listen to the bios of the 14 officers we've hired today. The reason why I say that, 27 years doing police work, I have never seen a crowd give a standing ovation before the end of the ceremony. Once Pete Simpson, our PIO, and you would recognize him, once he got done reading the bios of the 14 officers, people stood and applauded. It's an unbelievable group of people. Frankly, when I got hired, if I was competing against those folks, I simply wouldn't have got hired. They're that good. That gave me a breath of fresh air that the pendulum, I think, is swinging. The kind of caliber of officer is changing because they have a different heart than I think some of the older school folks when we started, right? We have to hire 385 officers in 5 years. Reason being, we have 385 leave. I think all of us up here are eligible to retire. You get these natural hire and retire waves. Two things cops don't like: change and how things are, right? We just don't as a culture. We're gonna be changing all the time. You got 385 people leaving in 5 years, that's massive. Pros and cons of that: you have a lot of history leaving, but if you wanna have a culture change pretty quick and accelerate it, you bring in 385 new people. We don't know any different, right? But the goal for us and everybody in this room, because they're all senior people here, is to train our new folks. How do you want folks in your officers in this city, how do you want us to police, provide police services in this town? The last thing I'll say, we'll move on, is has anybody seen or heard on the news? I was at a conference last week where the Attorney General spoke, Loretta Lynch, the Inspector General, I think that's his title, for Interpol spoke, Covey, the FBI director, spoke, and a guy named Terry Cunningham, who's the International Association of Chiefs of Police president. Now I'm getting some nods. Everybody see his 4.5-minute speech? Yeah, no? If you go on Google, and you just Google Terry Cunningham, IACP, it'll pop up. He gave a 4.5-minute speech in between Attorney General Loretta Lynch and the Interpol guy. I was in a room with probably 6,000 chiefs and high-ranking police officials. He got a standing ovation. What he talked about was the fact that we as police need to understand the history of policing in this country going back a couple hundred years. Just like, you know, I'm a religious guy. I kind of know the Christian Crusades wasn't all, you know, peaches and ice cream the whole time. There's some horrific events in the Crusades, right? There's some horrific events in policing in this country. We got to know that as police. It's kind of what we represent. And we have to acknowledge those injustices, learn from it, and go forward and realize there's still some going on. But he also called that it's a two-way street. We need to acknowledge that, and others need to kind of acknowledge what we're trying to do and to set up that dynamic, if you will, for conversations. And personally, that's where I think the healing begins. We've made mistakes. We also don't know everything that's going on. We also don't know all the cultures. How many languages are spoken in East Precinct? 87? There's about 87 languages spoken in East Precinct in this town. We're just not going to be masters and get everything right all the time with all the cultures. We're just going to make mistakes. We need to try not to, but then be able to have those dialogues with folks when we do, learn from it, and kind of move on. So the race relations piece, though, and I'll end with this. This is what I tell my new folks. It's either the best time to be in policing in the United States, or it's the worst time to be in policing in the United States. You got to pick a lane. When I say you got to pick a lane, it's like the folks that work for me got to pick a lane. I think it's the best time, because we're finally at that point after 25 years of community policing and race relations. I think we're actually getting to the point where we're about ready to start having conversations about it, finally. I think it's really important how we're going to have the conversations and how we move on. I think it's the best time, because with those conversations, you can actually give each other some grace to make mistakes, learn from one another, and move on. Because if we don't get this right, and that we is like the collective we, we're in a world of hurt. We really, really are. So I look at this as an opportunity, not so much as you know, we finally hit that point where everything's going to crash and burn. Like now, I think we're actually finally hit that point where we're going to take it and take off and get things better. That's just my own personal philosophy. So, good? 7 minutes? All right. Thank you.
Can I take
Mathew's
question?
Sure.
The next one is, let me give you the little sheet so you can see.
You're going to go in order?
We're going in order?
Hey. So, did I put one of these there for you guys?
We have an evaluation.
Is
it on that?
Well, it's on there,
too.
So there you go.
Am I up?
Yep.
Okay. So, hi. My name is Chris Uehara. I am a native of Hawaii, and I came to, so born and raised, obviously, in Hawaii. I came to Oregon to go to Pacific University in Forest Grove in 1986.
Go Boxers.
And to tell you, go Boxers, Donna, absolutely. And to tell you the truth, that was my first experience with race and what race really was as far as from a discriminatory standpoint. What happened was I was at Bi-Mart, and obviously growing up in Hawaii for 17 and a half years, I was a lot darker because of the sun and all. And so so being a really dark-skinned, short hair, black hair person, I'm standing in line at Bi-Mart to buy some college snacks, ramen, right? And a guy behind me mumbles under his breath, "Hurry up, you effin'," and he called me a derogatory Hispanic name. And I thought to myself, I don't think he was talking to me. I mean, he must be talking to someone else in the line. And I turn around and I look, and the guy is standing behind me. And what had happened was, where I was standing, the person in front of me had changed and gone over to another check stand, which meant I was up. And I didn't move because I wasn't paying attention to it. And he said this derogatory thing to me. And I thought, my gosh, he can't be talking to me, but he was. And so that was my first true experience of being discriminated against. And I thought, my gosh, heaven's sake, this is horrible. Well, it only got better. A couple months into it, I had a couple friends that I met through football at Pacific and some folks, and two of my friends are African-American fellows. And we were walking one night down to Cornelius to the Fred Meyer, and a car rolled by us. And some folks yelled out some derogatory names, the N-word, to my friends, and threw Löwenbräu beer bottles at us. Well, they weren't throwing it at me. They were throwing it at my friends, who happened to be African-American, because, again, they said the N-word. And I was taken aback by that. So it was amazing to me that, again, growing up in Hawaii, I didn't feel like I had a sheltered life, but everybody is ohana. I don't know if you all have heard that before. Ohana is a term for family in Hawaii. And so you accept everyone, regardless of what their race, their religion, their creed, or any of that. It's just kind of all-encompassing. And yeah, there's the stories about the Haoles, the white people, and all that. Take all of that with a grain of salt, because there's a lot of locals that are white, that are Haole people that are local Hawaiians, for the most sake, not Hawaiians in the sake of the actual race. So anyway, I went on and got my degree, came on to the police bureau, and I said to myself, if there was ever an opportunity in the organization to do something about that as a police officer, I would definitely take a stance and try to do something. And so I always try to preach, I always try to live by treating people with dignity and respect right up, not trying to see any, judging anybody by their color, their religion, their orientation, and taking people for who they are. The coolest thing happened, I mean it took forever, but the coolest thing happened in 2011. In 2011, the police bureau, some of you may or may not know this, entered into a partnership agreement with the Department of Justice, and we ended up taking many members of our organization over to the country of Bangladesh. and we did a community policing program over there. We took 114 police officers from the city of Portland to Bangladesh. 114 police officers, you need to know, is over 10% of our workforce that went and had an experience. The experience that they had, and the reason we did this, and the reason I was so passionate about making sure we did this as an organization, was to give people an opportunity and an experience to be a minority. Because here, obviously, regardless of who we are and what we're about, we're kind of the majority versus the minority. Go to Bangladesh, which is a third world developing country, go in there not speaking the language, not knowing anything, and relying on the goodness and the kindness and the compassion of the people. That is a major life-altering experience. And the goal was to go there, have this experience as police officers, and come back better people for it, which equated to becoming better police officers. I think we were successful. We ran this program from 2011 until the summer of 2014. And everybody that went to a T said it was an awesome experience. Everybody that went. And some people said, I want to go again. Others said, once was enough. Because again, we were there, we were immersed in the culture for 3.5 weeks, away from your families, away from all the creature comforts of the earth. So it was true experience of living in a third world country as a minority person. Everywhere you went, heads would turn, people would stare, people would look, but all you had to do was look over, give a little wave or a smile, and guess what? You were met with the same. It was a super powerful experience. Some of you may have heard about it in the news. It was carried just a little bit, not a huge blur, but it was awesome. Yes, ma'am?
I just wanted to ask, was it your idea that you wanted to do
this? It wasn't necessarily my idea. I was a captain over a division that had an opportunity to take this project and sell it to the chief, which didn't need much selling at that time. And Chief Marshman himself went. He wasn't the chief at that time, but he went and was one of the program leads too for us. It was just a tremendous experience. People questioned us and asked, well, how can you take police officers from the city of Portland when we have an issue here and you're taking them all the way across the world and everything? It was an investment. It was an investment in the city. It was an investment in what we do as police. So I just wanted to share that experience a little bit. I have a lot more stories I can talk to you about in the breakout session, but just wanted to give you a piece of that. Okay? Thank you. Thank you.
Going down the line, then I guess I'm next. Matt Wagenknecht. I'm the assistant chief in charge of the investigation branch. I just want to dovetail off what the chief was mentioning about education. Currently, we're teaching all officers about equity in their in-service training, and part of that is understanding who they are as police officers in the city of Portland, and it's teaching them about racism in the United States history, racism in the state of Oregon, racism in the city of Portland, and racism in the Portland Police Bureau. And there have been incidents that have happened in our past that we may not have been working during, or we may not have been hired, or we may not have been born during. But when we wear the badge, we own it. We absolutely own it. I talked to the class a little bit about it. I asked them, who remembers the possum incident? I grew up in the area here. I remember the possum incident. It's about 35 years ago. I was in the sixth grade, and I remember hearing about it on the radio every time my parents would drive me to school. That's my recollection of the possum incident, the Portland Police Bureau. However, there's citizens that were in their 20s and 30s who are in their 50s and 60s now, and they remember it like it was yesterday. And maybe that was the only contact that they had or the only thing they knew about the Portland Police Bureau. And so, you know, when the young 25-year-old cop comes to the door and they It's not about you. It's about this. And as leaders in the community, we need to understand that. And that's that communication piece, I think. That's the piece that we need to be understanding. And it opens the door for us to, you know, pick up the torch for our next generation and carry it forward on equality and equity and dealing with racism. You know, one of the things that really struck me when I was a young officer, I used to ride the horses downtown, horse patrol. And on the horse patrol, you're always downtown, so you have the same cast of characters. You know everybody, all the store owners, all the business people, all the bad guys, all the people that frequent downtown. And there was one guy that I knew particularly. He was one of the bad guys. He wasn't a bad guy. His name was Alan, African-American gentleman who had a drug problem. And back then, we had the drug-free zone. You all remember hearing about that. And so whenever I'd see Alan and he'd see me, he knew he was trespassing in the drug-free zone. I knew he was. I knew he had drugs on him. He knew he did. And he ran a couple of times, but most of the time he'd just give up. And we just did, that was our routine. That was our weekly routine. And Alan would go to jail, and that's what he did, and that's what I did. It wasn't until I contacted Alan, it was in Pioneer Square, and the drug-free zone had extended out to that location. And I saw Alan, he's in the drug-free zone again. So, Alan, come on, he'd come over, and I put handcuffs on him. And a lady came up to me and started chewing me out because what I had done, what I had done, and I didn't realize it, was I singled Alan out in a group of white people, picked him out, he came over, I put handcuffs on him, and the lady didn't know why I did that, other than maybe I was just picking him because he was African American. She came over and started to chew on me, and Alan chewed back on her and she left. And so he didn't understand what was going on either, actually. I told him, Alan, she was yelling at me, not you. She was upset with me. And at first I was a little upset, but then I realized, you know what? I missed an opportunity there. I missed an opportunity to explain what was going on. She left thinking that I was picking on him because he was black. And at that point, I was mortified. And that's the communication piece that we need to get a hold of. That's the communication piece that we need to, as officers, and I tell our officers, they're leaders in the community. As soon as they put that badge on and they go out there, they are leaders in our community, and it's their responsibility to understand and then offer that communication and the explanation, because without the explanation, nobody's gonna know. So for me, that was a pivotal point in my career when it came to police and racism and understanding each other and understanding the job that we're doing and understanding the position that we're in when citizens look at us and what they actually see or perceive. Because in a lot of ways, perception is reality. And if that's what their reality is, then that's what the narrative is gonna be. And so, thank you, I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Well, I'm the Assistant Chief of the Investigations Branch.
So that covers
eight divisions within the Investigations, Detectives, Drugs and Vice Division. Investigations within the Police Bureau. So criminal investigations.
I'm the Assistant Chief over the Operations Branch, which covers basically all of the three precincts, the Youth Services Division and the Traffic Division. So if you see them out there pretty much wearing a uniform, they're in our branch when you call 911.
I'm Mike Leloff. I'm the Assistant Chief of the Services Branch, and that's everything that supports those two. So it's the budget, it's personnel hiring, firing, discipline, professional standards. I do have one division that's uniform, and that's the Transit Police Division, but what else do I have? I have training division. Fiscal, $200 million budget, and so I have all the fun stuff, but basically he breaks it out into the services branch, which really is the support branch to the other branches. So I've been a police officer for 31 years, and I grew up in Klaskenheim, which is about an hour that way. It's a white little town, 1,700 people, and I graduated from high school in 1980. And through high school, I always just wanted to be a cop. I can point to middle school and high school, and I just wanted to be a police officer. My dad was a mill worker and was miserable. And he worked the conveyor belt, and he made newspaper. And he'd come home every day, and he raised the six children. He had his wife, and he made a good living. But he didn't enjoy his job. And he told me, go do something you want to do. Go do something you love to do. The old saying, do something you love to do and you'll never work a day in your life. So I became a cop at 23 years old in Cornelius, Oregon, in Washington County. And there was a lot of immigrants out there, a lot of berry-picking Hispanic young men. They lived in camps that were, my exposure to that was really, how do people live this way? And there's these little cramped quarters down there, excuse me, and I began immersion into the Hispanic culture, and I was trying to sort out who knows the term coyote? Anybody ever heard that term? Those folks would smuggle people across and then basically hold them hostage and threaten their families down in Mexico until they got paid their ransom to get you across. And it was a unique experience for me, and I did not speak Spanish. Learning to try to communicate, I'd stop people with no driver's license, and I'd stop people with no insurance, and I'd work through trying to communicate. And one day I remember the glove box folded open, and there's this big foil pack. And all you could see was a little bit of green, and it was a whole pack of money. As a young cop, I thought, well, we got a drug deal. And they opened it up, and it's all full of berry stains. And that was kind of an immersion into the Hispanic culture, where I really learned the hard work ethic, and I learned the conditions, the rough conditions that they lived in down in Mexico. And then I came over to, I moved over to Tualatin, which was mid to upper level, mostly white at the time, and then not enjoying that too much. I came into the city of Portland. I wanted more out of my career. I wanted to serve more. And I worked largely in North and Northeast Portland, working black gangs. And August of 1992, I saw a young man, knew him very well, and he was out on the street corner at 1201 at night. And at the time, you got to go back a little bit. At the time, it was there was a strategy to take him off the street for curfew and save his life. At that time, we were having a lot of gang shootings back and forth, and I knew the young man very well, called him by his first name, grabbed him, and I took him into JDH. And at 5:17 that same morning, 5 hours and 16 minutes later, we got a call of shots fired, and that young man laid in the street dead. And that's the young man I carry with me today. He was an African American, and his potential was gone. And I didn't know it at the time, but that would change my thinking years later. It didn't really strike me at the time, but what struck me years later was, it doesn't always work. Arresting people doesn't always work. And in 2011, I was chosen to be the commander of North Precinct, and I think I chose to do some things different, and I went to work into the African-American community, and I actually asked them what they wanted. And in Albina and Killingsworth is something that I'll cherish with me the rest of my life, but it was nine times, it was an area known as one of the nine locations for street robbery. It was known for gang killings, it was known for gang shootings, and you were three times more likely to be a victim of violent crime if you're an African-American male. So I went and met with a man, Algie Gatewood, and we began a partnership and we began a commitment to change. And the first concern the community had was stop and frisk. Don't do it like New York. That's what we heard. Like, okay. And then the second commitment was we can't arrest our way out of the problem. Okay, understood. And we began this conversation back and forth, and I realized the police were not meeting the vision of the community. And the community saw themselves as a vibrant community. If you know Albina and Killingsworth, there's Jefferson High School, there's Portland Community College, 24,000 students, 600 faculty members, Jefferson, 600 or 800 students. POIC, Alternative Last Chance High School, right there. Small minority businesses, right there. And they saw themselves as vibrant. They saw themselves as a community, and we weren't meeting their need. So, we formed a partnership, we signed a document, we said we were going to do certain things, we listed them out, and we did those things over a course of 6 months. We arrested a few people to set the tone, and then we couldn't arrest another one in the seventh month. And what's great about this story is we began really to work with a group called 1145. We started mentoring youth. Four judges were on board with us, along with the police and the district attorney. We were trying not to put young men of color in prison. And so they would have to do mentorship. And we worked with outreach workers. We worked with POIC and their outreach workers, and we really formed a partnership to where we were not, we were trying not to criminalize young people of color, because we know that that just leads into employment issues, school issues, things like that. So today, we still continue that partnership 4 years later. We lowered crime by 50%, and mostly what I didn't know at the time was what they're talking about now in the national narrative, building trust. And what we did back then, what we started back then, is meeting this chief's goal, building community trust and involving the community in the conversation. So appreciate being here tonight, and I love these opportunities, especially when we get into the small group. So thank you.
Our next speaker is Reverend Dr. T. Allen Bethel, and he is the pastor of Maranatha Church in Northeast Portland, and one of the co-chairs of the Albina Ministerial Alliance Peace and Justice Oversight Committee. So they do oversight for the Department of Justice. I think it's a real compliment to the organization that they are the only community organization given oversight of a police department in the country. So I don't know what they're doing right, but they're doing it. So, mm-hmm.
Thank you. Good evening.
And one of the things I would really like for you to share too is what it is you do, and what's the update on the COAB? And I know that things have changed with them lately. So what it is you need from the community for the COAB?
I work hard. If you want to know what I do. Under several different hats, but I think you're talking, we're going to focus more about what we're doing in the community to help bring about a difference in our community, where we live, and for all of our residents here in the city of Portland. The Albina Ministerial Alliance is an organization composed of many different churches and ministers in the northeast Portland area, has been in existence for over 60 years. It has worked in many areas such as civil rights, it's worked with economics, with education, with health, and in advocacy for the community. A number of things that happened, to mention the possum incident. We can come on up and just read a roll of things that happened where people lost their lives due to officer-involved shootings. And then this is an issue that came, and particularly, I don't know if you might remember, Kendra James. Well, after Kendra James, there was a group of people and organizations who formed feeling that Kendra James' rights had been violated and how her death occurred, and that went through a long investigation, trial, civil suit. Then after that came several other people, Mahalia Poot, Jahar Perez, and we can keep naming some names that brought us on up to come to James Chassie, Lee Chassie, and come to Keaton Otis. And we continue to talk about how do we bring about reform and justice in our community through our police bureau. We realized that there was something that needed to happen. We tried to have some conversation with district attorneys around the state of Oregon, and for a while I did meet in Salem along with police officers and high-ranking officers, and we talked about what we could do. Essentially, what came out of it was it's a Portland problem, because the other ones were not experiencing what Portland was experiencing, so they felt that they were isolated from it. Well, Portland got a lot of notoriety in the news because, being the big city that it is, it gets a lot of news coverage, perhaps more than some of our rural and smaller neighborhoods again. Well, Albina Ministerial Alliance wanted to continue to work towards how do we bring about reforms, how do we bring about justice. One thing I always like to say in meetings is that we want everybody to go home safe every day. Every day. And that includes police officers and everybody else. But in my profession, I don't want any bad one around. If he or she is a bad minister, I want them gone. I don't want them out there doing anything that impacts what I do and how people view what I do and what others do. We feel the same when we talk about officers, those who are not the good officers. We want them gone. And we want responsibility. We want justice. We want reform. We asked the Department of Justice to come in shortly after the Aaron Campbell's case to do an investigation on audit of patterns and practices of the Portland Police Bureau. That audit did take place. They found that there was an excessive use of force towards those who are with mental illness or perceived to have mental illness, and thus brought about what we know today as the settlement agreement. When that agreement was announced on that day, shortly after that, the Albina Ministerial Alliance Coalition, which is comprised of about 25 different organizations from around the city that join in and wants to see reform and justice. We also filed towards the federal court as an intervener to be able to be a part of the case and speak into the case. We did not have, I can put it this way, we didn't really have a big dog in the fight. So we didn't get intervener status, but the Portland Police Association got the intervener status, and we were granted what is known as enhanced amicus, an amicus friend of court, but an enhanced amicus status. I've had people in the Department of Justice ask me, what is that? We really didn't know. But what it did was it allows the coalition, through its representative voice, be a part of that federal case, and we have an opportunity to speak directly to the judge and yet work with the organizations, the city, DOJ, the PPA, to try to find ways in which we can bring about accountability, reform, and justice. We will be going on the next Tuesday at 1 o'clock. We will be at the Justice Department, Judge Simon's courtroom. We'll be giving our annual status report. The annual status report is where all four of the parties will present a status report to the judge as to where we are, what we're thinking, what we think might need to be done, what we need to do from here. So that will be coming up on that day. Normally, the courtroom is pretty well packed during those times, but Judge Simon has always made accommodations for as many people to come, even if we had to stream in another room to do that. So if you'd like to hear those reports, you can get in, get checked in, come on upstairs and be a part of hearing that. The COAB, the Community Oversight Advisory Board, was comprised of five advisory members, which were five members from the Portland Police Bureau, appointed by the Bureau. There were five appointees by city council. Each council person appointed one person. That gave 10. There were five more between the CRC and the HRC, and three more that they appointed got us to 15. Then there were the five that were a community at large that brought it to a board of 20. They've had some issues, they've had some challenges, both sides, all four sides. We, as I said, it's not to lay blame on one side or the other, but we all got to own all the blame that we had and really come to the realization that it was not working and we've got to do something about it. But we'll be meeting again on tomorrow with the city. I think DOJ is going to be present, trying to determine where do we go from here with the COAB. It's conceptual amendments. One of the ones on the table is to have one committee do this and one committee do that. There is an agreement on that as of yet. So we will do some kind of an update on that on tomorrow, 3 o'clock, with the mayor and others who will be coming in the room. I'm hoping that we can find a way to bring the COAB back. COAB has been on a hiatus, vacation, suspension, the last 60 days. Today ends the 60-day period. Tomorrow is the 22nd. COAB, it should be called back tomorrow, but COAB will not be called back tomorrow because the COAB is not fully functioning, and challenges on that as well. But there is a potential that the city could be found out of compliance by not having the COAB intact and meeting. So that's about all I can really tell you about and share with you about COAB. Unfortunately, when you are in a case, there are certain things you cannot say that you are aware of because of the confidentiality and the legal nature of it. But believe me, we're not doing anything illegal. We're not doing anything that, you know, will not come out, because it will be a transparent public record of that court, those proceedings, all the papers, everything that's filed. You have an opportunity to petition them and read them. But when you're negotiating, dealing with things, you just, and I think Marshman understands that we can't do some things. But suffice it to say, we are working, I think all four parties are working, trying to bring about a resolution. We want to see the whole process go forward. We do want to, and I'll say this because we have written this, we commend the CBA with the Portland Police Association for at least eliminating the 48-hour rule. There are things in the CBA that we agree with, speaking from the coalition's point, and there are things that we don't agree with. But we will commend those things that we agree with, and that's one of them that we've been working on trying to get eliminated and removed for a number of years. Glad to see that they were able and to do that, so we commend them for doing that.
Can you clarify which 48-hour rule? Is that the 48-hour rule in the current contract to review video footage? Or is that the having to testify or...
That had to do with when an officer is giving notice that he or she is to make their report, particularly when it's around an officer-involved shooting, and they had 48 hours notice to write it and submit it. Got a summary in it. And it has to go back with, what's the case I want to call it? What's the rules? Garrity rules. That's the one that's been eliminated. With the body cam language, that piece is still kind of somewhere under discussion about when and if they get to review the footage before they write their reports, or if it's something done afterwards. So that's a piece that was behind the CBA. Still, I think, has to have some more conversations on both parts. And my hopes is, this is me speaking personally, that we all can sit around a table and talk about what we agree on and begin to hash out what we don't agree on and try to find a workable solution. It's going to take communication, and I believe that we are at the point that we want to come together and communicate about those things.
Okay, thank you. So, know how the police started? How many of you looked up the history of the police in the United States? About three or four. Very interesting. Google it. Police first started in France in about 1700, late 1700s, and then they came to this country. And people who were police were punished. If you were arrested for something, then you had to go out and patrol at night and be a police officer. And the reason you had to do it is because it was dangerous. There were no lights. So the police started in this country in the early 1800s, and in the 1800s. And in the South, the police initially were started to collect and return runaway slaves. So there's a whole history here of what has the role been of the police. And I wondered why the police, there were so many Irish who were in the police force. And I consulted a good source, Blue Bloods. And y'all don't watch Blue Bloods? You gotta watch Blue Bloods, it's good. One of the things they talked about is that the Irish couldn't get jobs. when they came here. And so the jobs that were available were to be the police because it was such a dangerous job. So the police have held down a very important role, but it had nebulous starts. And the fact that the police are here to talk to the community, the fact that the police are saying, we want to get to know you better, we want to have a better relationship, this is a place to start. And so the things that you're getting ready to write down and to discuss today are extremely important. Even though you think, well, I'm just one person, your ideas can change the world. Here's one that will blow your mind. Do you know that an ant can eat an elephant? Mm-hmm. It'll take a long time, but it can eat an elephant. And so that's what you're here to do. If you look on the evaluation on the back, there are community discussion questions. There are three main questions. What do you see occurring presently in community and police relations? What would you like to see occur in community and police relations? And what are you willing to do to help improve community and police relations? Because we always want to talk about they need to do so. Who the heck is they? They is me and you. And so what are you going to do to change that relationship? One of the things that, how many of you have ever done a police ride-along? I have not done it before, and I am saying this is my, in the next 6 months I'm going to do it. Because I think it's a real eye-opener. It's a real eye-opener. It's kind of like, you know, they have new programs now where I mentioned men and birthing. They have new programs where men get to experience labor. So during your discussion of those three questions, consider these things: police stops, racial profiling, interacting with youth, independent police review. Now, the independent police review is an organization that's supposed to look at what police have done. It is changing. It needs to develop, as I like to say, a set of ovaries, and it's getting more there. The community's role in oversight. What are you going to do, and what is community policing? So this is an opportunity for you to give some dynamite suggestions. Think outside the box. Say whatever you want to say. And put this together and do it. Now, there's a couple of ways we can do this. We can do it with chart paper. And I would suggest, and officers, I would suggest that one officer to a table, so you can talk and get real personal. Or we can do it on the small pieces of paper. So that's up to you. Officers, spread out. And then what I will do is, if you want chart paper, send somebody over. I'll give you the chart paper. If you just want to use the small sheets of paper, help yourself. There is food over here. Let's just take a break. Come get refreshments. Set yourself up. And maybe in the next 5-10 minutes, be ready to go. My boys clap 3 times. Thank you very much for the applause. Before you leave, fill out the evaluation. Okay, so pick somebody from your group to come and share at least one thing that you guys talked about. I hope, how many groups wrote down what you talked about? Let's hear it for this table over here. Let's hear it for them, because they know how to follow directions. The rest of you don't. The rest of you don't, so you're on my list. And it ain't the good one. Okay, so the problem is that if you don't write down the things, the ideas you've come up with and your suggestions, then there's no way to save the information to share with the police. You're not going to bring about tangible change. The people that you are talking to will change, maybe, if they remember what you said. But they're mostly not going to remember what you said. They're going to know how they felt when they talked to you. You got to write it down. Y'all are a tough crowd. You didn't laugh at my little jokes. Now you didn't follow directions. Good Lord. Okay, so here's the deal. Can you remember one thing that was said at your table? One person, say something. Okay, so I'm gonna make an administrative decision. I would like each one of the officers to stand up and tell something that they heard at their table. And we'll start with you, Chief.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. Administrative decision. So, we kind of failed a little bit. We didn't write things down. But we had, I think, I don't want to speak for the group, we had good conversations where we kind of bounced around a little bit from the history in Portland, Bancorp redlining, to gentrification, to we had this interesting conversation is gentrification racism? We kind of went down that road for a while, but then we got into a conversation of implicit bias, and we think we know what it is, but then how do you overlay that to what we're talking about? So we kind of kept on kind of going around this, so I'm not sure if we actually wrote down anything.
So did you give us something concrete that you can take away and do to help make the police department more effective and relationships with the community better?
Yeah. So history matters. You got to understand the history, I think, to have a foundation, to have, even start to have a conversation.
Good.
And then as we start getting into some of the issues that happen specifically in Portland, having that foundation to have everybody talk about it, at least understand it, and then once you understand it, you know, what are you going to do about it? But I think for us, as for me, for the organization, teaching the history
to the officers.
To the officers, yeah. Every member inside the organization. And then once you have that foundation, you can start talking about conversations like, I asked Carlos, because he said, you know, gentrification, I got my bit in a spot, but you know, gentrification kind of turned as racism. So basically say, yeah, I'm understanding what you're saying, you know, I agree with what you said about the history. I'm lost from the gentrification to racism piece. And be able to actually have a conversation with somebody and go, I was good, and then I got lost it somewhere. You know, can you try again telling me what you're saying? And I think if we don't do that, you're not going to get anywhere.
Okay, so since y'all don't know how to follow directions, would you write down what they
I can
say?
Write something now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. All right. Officer you.
Yeah.
All right. Come on, stand up. We gotta see you.
So good evening. As Chief Marshman had mentioned, we had a great conversation over here. We discussed, as far as Port Police Bureau, we love the opportunity to interface with the community. And we also love the opportunity to just have these organic conversations. And so, with respect to what the Chief said, we didn't drop the ball. We had a great organic conversation.
Yeah.
No, we truly did have a great organic conversation. There was some, I'm fascinated as a police officer to hear the opinion of the public. We work for the public, and it's important that our organizational values mirror community expectations. And so I love these venues and these opportunities to hear, okay, well, I know why I'm here as a police officer, and I know why my supervisors are here, but I'd love to hear your story. Why are you here? So we had that opportunity to get to understand and hear the story a little bit. There was some questions about organizational accountability, the culture within the police department. Words I remember hearing is like the thin blue line, and where we culturally within the organization, has that changed? Is it getting better? So we had some great discussions as far as maybe old school styles of policing and kind of the at one time, for lack of better terms, like the machismo attitude, and how that's really transitioned to cultural accountability, where one of the examples we talked about is nobody, in my opinion, has a better or higher vested interest in holding police accountable than the police officers themselves. We know, we discussed, not all police officers are created equally, just like not all clergy, not all doctors, not all teachers are created equally, and it only takes one bad incident or one bad apple, per se, to taint perception of an entire occupation. And so we discussed how organizationally we hold each other accountable, and I'm proud to work for an organization that does that. And so we got into some great conversations as far as what is the community expectation of Portland Police Bureau, and then hopefully we had the opportunity to kind of answer some of the questions. We discussed also, it's very easy when a controversial situation happens to say the police must need more training. And as a former trainer, I'd love to hear the public's perception as well. How much training do you actually believe the Portland police officers receive? And so we went into our training a little bit as far as being a progressive agency and how well educated our agency actually is. And then we discussed kind of some of the training as far as mental health crisis. We discussed Vanport and stuff like that. So although we, with respect to the script, it was a great script, we had a lot of great conversations.
Okay, so what I heard you say that you're going to enact is more organic community discussions.
Oh, they're fabulous, absolutely.
And getting input from the public as to what kind of training is needed.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm paraphrasing, which kind of well boiling it down. Okay, we're got you. Y'all can talk. I thought I was a talker. Okay, so AC, you were hired.
So I'm going to talk about overcoming some obstacles.
Okay,
and
so and because I want people to have a chance to network, we're going to keep you guys to 1 minute apiece so that we have the last 15 minutes for everybody to network.
Way to go, Nate.
So Onisha here has every reason to hate the police and to hate everything we do, but she does not. And she has overcome some huge obstacles in her life, and so I want to give her a round of applause. And here's the deal. So my takeaway and the table's takeaway is to look at all the data before rushing to judgment and to forming opinions. Make sure that your opinions are educated opinions, and don't follow social media and just look at that and think, that's the way it is. Root down, dig deeper. That might be the catalyst that gets you started, but there's a whole lot more narrative in there, and it's your responsibility to go and search that out.
So it sounds like you developed the R word, relationship.
Yes.
So what needs to happen is there needs to be more relationship between the police and the community.
Absolutely.
Okay. And that is something that can happen with the community discussions. Stand up, come on, you're cute. Let everybody see you.
I think, yeah, it goes back to the relationships. I think it's just recognizing the relationships that we've already built and maybe be able to explain all that. We have tons of relationships in the community, long-term, short-term, that we have that people aren't aware of. And so some of the things they're asking for, we're really, really good at. It's just it's overshadowed by the perception that's not always real.
So what you're going to do in the future is put out there, let the community know more of what your relationships are.
No.
It's not that cute anymore, is it?
Develop more relationships.
So you're saying develop more relationships?
No, just making people aware of the relationships that we have and the things that we have been doing.
So develop, so kind of...
What you said the first time before I was a smart...
Smarty.
Alley.
Okay.
I think Larry took up my time.
So we just had discussions about the expectations of police officers during encounters, the expectations of not only using the least amount of force, if any force is necessary at all, but de-escalation as well. And so they continue to train of de-escalation techniques, continue the training on equity, and moving forward with community gatherings such as this for understanding from both sides.
Okay, more community forums, more equity, and...
De-escalation.
I like that.
And what was the other word? You talked about more equity training and more...
De-escalation
training. All right, thank you.
My name is Mike Bledsoe, and I'm a Southwest Manager Responsible Officer.
I like you. You told your name. Thank you.
Yeah. So I'm here with Mike and Meg, and some of the takeaways that I got from this conversation that I can't talk about some of them because the chief has stolen from me. But we did talk about the community engagement piece as it pertains to education and on how to deal with law enforcement in a time of crisis. And Mike brought that up. He was pretty enthused about it, actually. He thinks that, I'm paraphrasing here, correct me if I'm wrong, that we need to have some kind of an education on how to interact, even though you feel like you're in the right, if you're being arrested by a police officer, how do you interact without exacerbating or increasing the use of force? And that's a hard conversation to have.
Is that what you're saying, training the public?
Yeah, yes, and we never got around as to how we were going to do that, so the idea I had was, through youth groups and church groups, or maybe a PIO piece, but...
Well, that can be another future talk.
Sure.
Is around that, but if you have the idea, then you're focused on what you're looking for.
I agree. And then May brought up an example of not institutional, but generational biases or racist, not racist police, but the notion that folks feel like they've been the victims of racism for generations, and how that affects a person's interaction with the police at their time of crisis, and how that exacerbates it as well.
So that's part of that learning the history. All right, thank you. You know what, we didn't clap for the people who already spoke. Okay, let's take it over here.
You first.
So I guess I better introduce myself. I'm Chris Davis, commander of Central Precinct. Alexis here carried this team because she actually took notes. So one of the things that we talked about was trying to get more, you know, we got a lot of command people in here, trying to get more service delivery people, officers, sergeants, detectives, into conversations like this. And one of the things, suggestions we had was because, just being real about it, a lot of folks in those roles don't feel safe in an environment like this. It's just a perspective issue. It's not that they aren't safe, it's just they don't feel safe. Police officers, service delivery level people. So one suggestion to get around that. Pardon me?
They're afraid we're going to beat them up?
I think they're afraid of getting beat up. But, I mean, it is what it is. It's how they feel, a lot of them. You can't speak for all of them, and I applaud the ones that are here. Because it takes a little bit of courage to do that, I think. But one great opportunity to have those kind of conversations with those folks is go see them in their native environment and come on a ride-along. And then you've got maybe 8 or 10 hours where you can have one of those kind of ongoing good discussions. And there's a lot of really positive community police officer relationships that come out of those. I won't steal all of these because I know that AC here wants something to talk about.
You did so well. How come we have to do all the public speaking? How come they don't? Because you said,
we
I know.
We pay you. We have a speaker.
So, you know, we talked about a couple of things, you know, recognizing the national crisis and acknowledging it. And then we got into really, you know, the role of police 20 years ago and what we all kind of began 31 years ago for me and many of us is reduce crime and fear crime. And that's what we did.
What was that?
Reduce crime and fear crime. And when we started police work, that's what we used to do. We'd go out and reduce crime, fear crime. That was our number one thing. And this chief, building community trust, that's his number one goal. Right? And so we're doing a role reversal. In fact, we talked to the young kids today. We call them kids again. And if you're effective at building your community trust, you can still be the crime fighter. But do this first, do this second. And so, really just talked a lot about that and a number of other things, and had a great conversation.
Great, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. David Cormick. I work at Central Precinct, the Neighborhood Response Team. I get the opportunity to join this today. It's very interesting, the discussion that we had. I think the biggest thing that I pull from this group as we were kind of dialoguing on this topic is information that is put out in the media and on social media. There is no doubt that the police in general are, you know, they're put under extreme scrutiny, and in many times that scrutiny is deserved. However, there's always a national negative bias, seemingly, on the police. And so perhaps the way to build some trust back is to communicate back to the community through modern means, whether it be Facebook, Twitter, all of those things more aggressively, of all the positive things that the police do on a daily basis. In this country, there are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of positive police contacts that don't use force, where people are saved from extremely harsh circumstances. Those things happen every day, but it's quiet and it's not newsworthy. And so maybe we could change that narrative a little bit.
I'm Jason Pearson, Lieutenant out of East Precinct, and for me it felt like we kind of went off script a little bit, but I think we started with the first question.
You're the only group that went off script.
It seemed like we started with the first question, and then it just went to feelings and perceptions and misperceptions and where these perceptions come from, which I thought was good, because rather than, you know, just stick with the script for the script's sake, let's talk about how we're feeling and how we got to where we're feeling. And, you know, whether we think we're right or wrong or indifferent, it doesn't matter as long as we're talking about it and getting a solution for it. So that part felt good. We talked not so much, I think, on some of the historical stuff, but kind of what's going on right now and where these feelings are coming from right now. And some recent events that kind of pushed those to the forefront. And, like Dave said, how are we going to get past those and move past those and get to a common goal?
Great, thank you.
officer at East Precinct on afternoon shift. This is going to sound similar, but kind of a little twist on it. We talked about what is put out in the media as opposed to what we as police officers maybe perceive. And the example that was given was the recent mayor's office, city hall issue around our contract negotiations. We as police officers kind of understand what was going on, even if we weren't there, we at least understand the process of why things happened the way they did. But the community maybe didn't get that information, or they don't see it from the same standpoint that we do. So maybe in some way getting the positive, or not positive spin, but the information of why we do what we do when things maybe look negative on the surface, to at least do some education of sometimes the necessity for a way to make things safe for everybody, even though it doesn't always look good on the surface.
Okay, so what I heard was educating the public, using social media, and opening conversation with having more dialogue.
You was our note writer.
Okay, sounds good. All right, let's hear it for that table.
The last table. I'm Ryan Brenner. We're at East Precinct. I'm a patrol sergeant over there. The crux of what we talked about really revolves around the last question. And it comes from a place of training and influence and teaching. How do you as police officers, or specifically how do you as supervisors and leaders, influence those changes upon your police officers? And that came to be through a series of really questions, kind of asking us, challenging us about some of our experiences, and well, how do you come to a decision point, and how do you formulate your opinions when you go to calls, and then how do you go forth and share some of the lessons that you learn as experienced individuals with the younger generation, and how do you affect that change that we all desire? I mean, it sounds very simplistic, but we really sort of came to the two means of delivering that message. And one comes in the form of giving sort of concrete skills and a sense of history in the form of teaching at like an in-service environment. The other comes from sharing your firsthand experiences, good and bad, when a moment presents itself. As a supervisor, as a leader out there in the field, when you see your officers interacting with folks, getting them to really think about and ultimately sort of learn on their own how to better sort of connect, relate, understand where somebody's coming from, so that you can understand not only what's going on right now with the problem that's before you, but what brought them to that point, and just being able to understand where somebody has come from to get to this place of conflict is very important in taking those steps forward and learning.
Okay. Is she a police officer?
No, but she had mentioned that she wanted to make some comments. So.
Okay.
No, I mean, it's fine. If you...
No. Stand up.
It was just summarizing kind of what the officer Brian here was saying, and I guess you know.
Can you guys all hear her?
No.
Okay, I was just saying that you know Brian kind of summarized everything, but I also wanted to say we did a survey on perceptions of Portland police officers. So if you are all ever interested in seeing that, I would be happy to share that. We kind of did that for SurveyMonkey, and one of the issues with that was that the survey was, just not targeting specific groups of people in the community. So that's what we did. We talked about that. We talked about implicit bias and kind of like everyone's experiences as police officers.
Okay.
I'm Wendy Stein.
appointment in the chief's office, executive officer to Chief Leloff and Chief Wagenknecht. I do a little bit of work for both of them. So it summarized pretty much what we talked about, so I'll share something personal that I felt. You mentioned that we feel uncomfortable or may feel some discomfort. I definitely felt some discomfort. One of the questions that was asked by a member of our table was, so after this, after tonight, what do you do with this information? You know, do you take it back to your organization and share it with people? And I was like, I really don't know the answer to that. And so I've been thinking about that question ever since it was asked. So we talked about training, you know, in-service training, but I think it's more, it has to happen more on a daily basis where we talk about it and it just becomes part of our culture where we discuss it. But I'll have to think about it some more.
Thank you. So one of the things, there's a group called, I can't remember, it's the ministers, it's Reverend Hennessy and the ministers.
Hennessy.
Yeah, what's that group?
1145?
No, it's not 1145, it's the ministers group.
Every Friday.
Yeah, at the North Precinct.
They don't have an official group yet, not a name yet, but yeah, it's the pastors.
It's pastors. So one of the things that I recommended at this group, I ain't a pastor, the thing that I recommended was kind of encompassing some of what all of you said, which was to give police officers their cards and that every week they need to pass out so many cards and just pick a block that's in their patrol area and go to every door and knock on the door and drop off their card and introduce themselves to the people in the community. And have a little note that if the people aren't there, that they drop the card in the post, in the mailbox or whatever, that says, "Hi, I'm Officer Friendly, and I came to meet you, and I'm on duty here, and give me a call and let's talk." So this is a way for people, I mean, I have no clue who patrols my neighborhood. No idea. I know police go through because I live in St. John's, and the motorcycle police are out there in that area. But who would I call if there was a problem? I don't have a relationship with my officer. So we go back to the R word, relationship. And a lot of the things that you all talked about were building relationship. And I think every chief has some level of that. It depends on their experience and how comfortable they are with it. And I think O'Day started it, and I see you carrying it on. And I think your experience as a Catholic is very, very important. Very important, because until there's a saying, walk a mile in my shoes or walk a mile in my moccasins. Until you have done that, you don't understand how other people feel. So if you look in your baskets, I want to thank you all for coming. There's two things I'd like for you to do. Number one, grab an evaluation and fill it out. Fill out as much or as little of it as you want. Please fill out the demographics so that you, that information like how old you are, your ethnicity, blah, 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 blah. If you're an officer, would you please put that on there, that you're, you know, with your PPP. And then the other thing is, you know, the little business card deal. Give the officer your name. Give them your number. Let them call you. You call them. Get to know each other, because until we get to know each other as human beings, as people, it's never going to get better. And, you know, I can walk around. I belong to a church that says that there's two basic emotions, love and fear. And all the rest of them emanate from those two. So show your love, give them your number, ask them to call you, do a ride along, and share with each other what life is all about. So we've got a few minutes left, and just network, get to know each other. invite people to get together for coffee. You know, there's always the joke that police like coffee and donuts. So go meet them for coffee and donuts if that's what you think they like.
That was a joke, right?
It's lattes and scones.
Oh, lattes and scones now. We have definitely gone Portland.
When are we going to come meet up and get
it's not going to happen.
So, thank you so much for coming, and leave your evaluations and stuff on the table, leave your notes on the table, and we will see to it that they get picked up and that we do share it with the officers. So, thank you much, and we'll see you at the next race talks at the Quinneman's Kennedy School and the next race talks too at Marshall Franklin High School at the Franklin site on November 16th, Wednesday, November 16th. Thank you.